here with Ken, who we've already met, and I've asked Ken to sit with me. We're going to sit in conversation together, and Ken is going to invite me into his way of listening deeply with another person. So we invite you to share with us as we share together. Ken, would you tell us just a little bit about yourself and perhaps this special day, why this today is special for you?
Oh, yeah, well? Actually, I'd forgotten until Marty just reminded me of it there. Back on the 25th of June 1985, which is 33 years ago today, I had a basically a spiritual rebirth, or been reborn, as you might say, totally unexpected. I've never had any religious. Quite the opposite, actually, growing up.
Mm.
I thought when you were dead, you were dead.
Yeah.
And I lived life accordingly.
Okay, yeah.
Which, one of the great sayings, which I'm sure you'd know, is it's the greatest sinners make the greatest saints. And that was my solace for the way that I'd been in my life.
Mm.
It's like only those who go too far know how far you could go. And I guess what my, in my understanding now, because the last 33 years, which only don't seem like any time at all, because I feel like I'm just in one moment since then. And it's been my endeavour since then just to learn how to be in the world. I have a saying, you can't change who you are, but you can change how you be who you are. So there's nothing broken with you, there's nothing wrong with you, and if you've been around people who don't fully understand you or stand under your understanding, your mind, as I say, if you aren't on top of things in your life, you're out of yourself and you're ahead of yourself.
Yeah, okay.
You're away from your body of information. And if you come home to yourself and you pull your head in and they go sticking your nose into other people's business trying to find something, or looking for something, what you're missing is already here, but it was never acknowledged within yourself. No one ever saw you, or you were never seen. And it's by listening to people and hearing people, but if we don't know who we are, then who's listening?
Yeah.
It's a personality that's listening, and every personality as a intention, they're already intentions, so you can't be comfortable with someone whose intention, no matter what the intention is, even if it's a good intention,
right.
The road to hell is paved with good intentions. So, and this is what hurts people, because I'm only trying to help. So you're a very trying person. Right? Just be who you are. But I don't know who I am. Well, I didn't know love. I'd never experienced love. And then when I was, and I'd been down the bottom and I went to the top and I pushed it to the maximum. And I gave up and I thought, this is it. I can't. I just let go, and I virtually did. I went down a big black tunnel and went through that. And when I came back through that again, I was virtually here for the first time, as it were. I was born in the spirit, as it were. And it was profound, and I thought, I've always been this. People said, you've changed. I'm just, and even a good friend of mine just said, who had known me for many, many, many years, a younger person than myself, and he looked at me the other day and he just said, Ken, you've always been like this. You just didn't know who you were. You didn't, and you weren't comfortable with that.
So there's a sense of arrival.
And acceptance and acknowledgement of myself. So, coming back to it, I've learnt many, many things. It's not, you can talk about religions, you talk about practices and new methods and therapies and thing. I've dabbled in all of it, because since that time I already knew what was going on. I wonder what all these people were doing. Why are they doing this? Why are they doing that? So I explored a great many things. One of the greatest things I found was Hermann Müller, Indian German, but primarily an Indian gentleman, and he, without going into all of his history, you can Google Hermann and find out. He passed away just last December in his 70s, late 70s, and he instituted of the government accredited certificate course in psychosomatic therapy.
Okay.
Or metaphysics.
Yeah.
Or the magic of body mind communication.
Okay. Yeah.
So to be able to look at somebody and see how they, what foundations they had in life.
Yep.
With their ankles, whether they felt supported in life.
Okay.
Their ankles can be rolling in on the left side, so if they never felt inner support from their mother,
yeah,
it will be shown in their form.
Yeah.
Because we're a result of our environment.
Mm.
And then how they grew up and your understanding, how you withstood things, how you stand.
Mm.
Like the gout of a man will tell you a man how he walks.
Yeah.
I just look at people walking along the street and I can glance at someone and sit there and talk to you for half an hour about them just by glancing at them.
Mm.
Because it'll imprint on me, I'll look at them and I'll just go, oh, they're doing this, they're doing that, they're doing this.
Yep.
This is because of that. Da, da,
da, da. Yeah, okay.
So you've asked me to give you a little bit of an insight into your
That'd
own...
That'd be great,
your
yeah.
own form, yeah? How you face the world and how you actually discern your way in the world and how you interact and how you function and get information and how you hold your own space, yeah? So we're always... Really, when we meet somebody, we get a feeling from them straight away.
Yeah.
We may not know what that is, but it's a feeling we get, and then we get to know them, and we go, oh, that's, oh yeah, that's what I felt about them. And people will speak, and we'll get more information. Oh, I had that feeling about them from the start, but I wasn't quite sure what it was. It was just something.
Yeah.
And especially if we have a... We're blessed to have a females around us. They will be very intuitive. Some of them can give you great insight and say, look, don't trust that person.
Okay.
Why? I don't know. I just have a feeling about them. Well, I'm very intuitive, which is my feminine nature within myself. I'm very intuitive about people. So learning to trust that. People say, how do you learn to trust? I say, by trusting.
Yeah.
There's no other way.
Yeah.
Because once you trust in that, then you trust in that, then you gain confidence in that only by trusting that.
Yes. Okay. Yeah.
So what's the major thing that jumps out at somebody when you first see them? It's like, oh, I don't like the look in their eye, I don't like this about them. But something will get our attention. So when I look at you, and already with understanding what it is that you do as well, and I've heard you speak, you have quite a strong bridge here in your nose here.
Okay.
And it's quite deep. And this part here is quite definite.
Okay.
There's no, that's what jumps, it's like. So this is the dividing line. This is between the left and the right side, how you feel and how you think. So how you think about things and how you feel about those things. As I was showing the images, when we split the face and make a face of the thinking person, a face of the thinking and the feeling person. So, never the twain shall meet, as they say. Don't let the left hand know what the right hand is doing. So if you meet somebody, meet as in connect physically with your meat. Once you connect and meet with somebody, then you, if you get this information goes into your feeling side, you can have reactions and emotions or energy, emotion will be activated because the physiology will start to remind you of some feeling of this person is reminding me of this. And the hormones are released into the body with the peptides in them and the instructions of the mind going down into the body to create either fight or flight, which will go into the muscle ready for action. And you cannot stop that once it's happened. So how can you think clearly? You need to be able to go, hang on a minute, let me think about this first. So having this strong bridge, that allows you to divide.
Okay.
And to be a definite, so to do what you do, you're able to go, okay. And it's like this, you like go, well, okay, now I'm going to be discerning here.
Okay.
I'm going to discern between what I feel and what I think. And you're quite open here as well, so your spiritual eye and your knowing is quite present.
Okay.
And this is extension, so what you think here has to get down to here to be able to get given birth to through the mouth.
Okay.
So it can't get down there unless it gets through here. If someone's like got a monobrow like aggro, the puppet,
Yeah.
Can't get through here, and that's why he's frustrated and angry, because there's a bridge there that can't be accessed down to really say what he's feeling and thinking.
Yeah. Yeah.
Which is connected to the solar plex, our identity.
Yeah.
And those is our identity, what we notice.
Yeah.
How much do you notice?
So
your nose comes out and it's quite pointed, right? And it gets to a point, so you get to the point. You're quite broad here, so you have that ability to hold that there in the heart.
Because
the eyes are the windows to the soul. So your eyes are window shows how you feel about it. So what you think comes down here, oh, it's a little dip there, right? So it drops in there. So the thoughts come down, and before they go down into the identity to make your point, it goes to a bath of the heart.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah.
To add feeling to it.
Yeah.
So you won't just go straight from your head, like you've heard the term, he's a hard-nosed businessman. His nose will look like it comes like a bone out of his head and goes straight down. So he's what he thinks, his identity, and he'll just go like this, man, you got no heart. No, I'm here to do business. I don't care about feelings, I don't care about heart. Hard-nosed business person. So someone's got a little dip like that, they will drop through there to give a bit of heart to it and say, okay, let me feel about that first before it comes down, before you make your point. My nose is quite broad, so I cover a lot of ground. I'm very giving.
Okay.
Big nostrils, so I take in a lot, but I give out a lot. Someone with small nostrils, can be stingy with themselves. They don't take in a lot, and as a result, they don't give out a lot. But again, I come back to it, and the width of this is thinner than here, so this is quite thick. So the ability to hold that center point like that, and to hold focus with your mind, which you're obviously very flexible, so it's rounded.
Okay.
It's not like this and like this.
Okay.
It's not like, it's like this and it's like this. It's like, you're willing to be flexible in how you think. And very open there. This is wide and open. So your spiritual vision is present. Now you're physically looking also. Your sense. As I say, when our intellect surpassed our instincts, was the day we lost our inner sense. And didn't trust anymore what we sensed. And then head office takes over.
I can hear that.
So the other thing brought my attention too, then I come to your ears. So your ears are a little bit forward. This one even fractionally more than the other. So from a child in your environment, as I've got my left ear more so, you had to have an ear out.
Okay,
to check where your mother was and what state she was in, so she couldn't come up and catch you unawares to do you any damage to your feelings and sense of who you felt you were. So you needed to have an ear out, so she were guarding, in other words, as like, what's going on? So the ear's growing like that. To keep an ear out. It's a little, not worth mentioning, but they're down in the emotional area, so they're below the eyebrows, and they also enter below the nose, which is into the physical, so you're more interested in listening to what you feel, and to your emotions, than you are listening to the head.
Okay, yeah.
If they're up here, like, good examples, Dr. Spock. Their logic. So they accentuate that by having pointed ears, meaning they're pointed, they're listening here all the time. Not listening to emotions or feelings. They're not Vulcans, they're not like that. It's funny cartoons, they're like that. And then they come the classical, we come down into the physical region through the emotion. So when you smile, and you give me a smile, through the cheeks here, you've got quite fleshy cheeks, you say you're a nurturing person. Right? Someone's got no flesh there and they've dropped out, they're kind of, they're not a nurturing person. It's like with a dimple, someone's really cute. It's like, you know, you have so much.
Yeah.
And then we look at someone, we get that We empathetically feel that from people, and this is why you make an impression on someone before you say anything, just through what we face.
Yeah.
And people get reading us all the time. If someone comes with you reading me, I say, well, you've been getting read all your life. I can't tell you anything you don't already know. It wouldn't make sense to you.
Yeah.
It's your information. You are information. You will perform per the form that you've created in this life. So when we come down into your physical region, which is below your nose here, and goes across here, straight across, you see here you've got quite a jaw that goes like this and like this. So it's like this.
Yep. Okay.
So when push comes to shove, you can't push against the right angle.
Yeah, okay. Yeah.
It won't. Yeah. You can physically, someone can say, well, once he makes up his mind and he starts to move forward, I would get out of the way because that's not going to give.
Yeah.
Whereas if someone who hasn't got that angle in the jaw, they can be more easily upset.
Okay. Yeah.
Although they can be more flexible in how they apply themselves.
Yeah.
Whereas this person, when they make up their mind to go forward, then they, when push comes to shove, they're the ones that are going to be pushing hardest because they've got a feeling of support behind them. Like if I sit in the chair and put my arms like that, then I'm, you can't upset me. So then the Marlborough man with the big square jaw is like a D9 bulldozer. He'll just nail, which women are attracted to because physiologically they sense that they're going to feel they're going to be supported. Because this man can hold his ground. When he makes a decision in life, he's going to chew through it. And he's going to be able to swallow it. Incision, decision, there's an incision, we bite in it, don't bite off more than you can chew. If you don't have a strong jaw, you won't be able to physically manifest this or carry these thoughts that come down. You won't give voice to them, but you won't be able to support it physically in the world. You'll have other things you're good at. It's not, nothing's good or bad. It's understanding your form and how you're functioning in the world. So even though it's quite wider up here, but then it comes down to narrows down here. So when you're coming forward, you're not like a D9 bulldozer. You've actually got a blade on you that comes through like this and throughout the bottom. So it's come to a small point. It's got like a little bit of a softening here. So you apply that force behind there in the best way you can get that through.
Right. Okay.
Giving consideration through your, because you're really heartfelt, because you're a nurturing person. You're very flexible in your thinking. You also can be flexible in how you actually apply that. I also see there's a little bit of flesh there when you put your head down. So this bit of flesh here is what that's doing. It's softening, endeavouring to soften what it is that you say. Because you don't want you trying to soften your words, because people take, have reaction to what you're saying, so you've tried to figure out the best way to soften. And then we start talking yourself to you, can you listen to what I'm saying? Try not to upset another, or off-end them. Want to keep them grounded and be, let them to be able to hear what I have to get the message across. So you've been doing that. And then there's a, in our lips show the taste for life. How we've tasted it. My experience was of very bitterness. It wasn't very sweet. It was my interpretation of my life. I didn't say that's how it was. I'm not, there's no blame on anybody. It's how I interpreted it. So it's like that. So there's no, wasn't any real so much sweetness, which I learnt a great many things through. There's nothing's good or bad. Again, only thinking makes it so. Nothing's good or bad, only thinking makes it so. So your lips are quite actually full. So, but I also sense there's a holding in your mouth. And again, I can appreciate it's understanding because of what you've been through and what you've learned and what you've experienced and what you've been doing in your life. If kind of being careful about your words that you've chosen. So there's a holding there that is not natural. hesitancy to, especially in your thinking side, there's more, this side is more willing to smile in the joy that you feel within yourself, that you've found within yourself.
Mm.
Whereas this side is still quite stoic and kind of like, I've got to hold to the order, so to speak.
Mm.
But your lips are actually quite full, and even now I'm talking about them, they're relaxed more and they've come out more full. So you're very sweet, you have a sweet taste for life. You've got like a little bit of like what we call a Cupid's bow there, so there's quite refinement in that, where it's quite, it's a sensuality and a sexuality, so there's a good sense of that. And one of the primary things that I see in our culture now is that if people want to do any correction of themselves, and primarily the only way that we can correct ourselves if we physically try to, you were saying before, someone said, oh, you know, lift up your chest and breathe out. But if we're feeling that weight on our chest all the time, it's very difficult to just physically do that, because within our inner being it doesn't feel like that. And if it doesn't feel like that, you can't be like that. Wow, that was a hard day, you know. God, I just sat with this person, they were really heavy and they were really hard, and it's like, and if we're around people like that all the time, we're feeling the apprehension and that heart, like, and then her heart needs a heart starter again, and that's why people, they don't, oh, it's no good crying, it's no good feeling these feelings, because there's no answer to it, just got to buckle up and keep going. But our physical and emotional bodies suffer from that. And I say, well, you know, it's like, I have a word, I call it laughter. It's love and it's laughter. Because when we cry, it's like, to start your heart going, it's like you can... And that's the crying of a child, be like that. Yet it's like... So that... is a... where we can free ourselves again by allowing that to... Again, if we don't have community, where we can come around people and feel like we're acknowledged, accepted, it's okay to be who you are, we see you. What happened to you today? I can see it in your face, this, you know, you're right. Oh, someone knows me, I can be myself. But when you're around people who don't know themselves, and we want to be connected, we relate to them, we're like, ah, and we start connecting on the same level just to have acceptance from them. And if we come in to try and bring love into someone, we'll activate their hurt and we'll be hurting them. You're hurting me, you know, it's like, you're already hurt. I go to someone, I go, whoa, what's going on in here, you know? And they go, oh, don't do that, that really hurts. And I say, well, it's already hurting, that's you're just not aware of it. But how can I be aware to put my finger right on it? Because I can see the way you're holding, or you're not you, but your body.
Your body's responding to...
is protecting itself. So it's protecting the heart, the shoulders like this, because of this, what you're speaking about. To open up again and take an onslaught when I haven't actually gone, done it on the deep inner levels where I just am that. And people say, don't you take on all people's stuff? I said, I'm not taking in, I'm giving out. I'm shining. Nothing goes into the sun. Only light comes out of the sun. You can't put anything back into the sun. But if we're contracted, then things will go in. Because it's pulling in like that way. So then what we do, getting back to where I was making the point, is we get ahead of ourselves. Because we want to get away from feeling that. Because we're trying to put on a good face. So I get out here, then I get away from my feelings. I leave my home. And I go ahead of myself to try and think my way through it and try and get my head around what people's saying. It's like, what are they really saying? And then that becomes a pain in the neck. Like, did I do a pain in the neck trying to listen to what I don't understand what they're saying? And then we come back and we come back here. And even when I come back here, you can difference between my voice between here and being when I put my head forward. There's a strangeness in that, but when I keep coming back and I keep coming back, then there's a, because the throat chakra's on top of things, then I'm a lion. I'm somebody is supporting me.
Yeah.
Somebody is standing under me, so I feel understood, and I feel supported with my head of knowledge up here.
Yeah.
I'm not sticking my nose if I do that. It's not comfortable. Straight away, so you'll flicker then, and your eye went, oh, whoa, whoa, whoa. Yeah,
he's coming closer.
He's coming close, but he's not. Nobody's here.
Yeah.
Nobody's here.
Yeah. Yeah.
Whereas if I come over closer and just bring my body over, your body can feel that I'm okay, but when I stick that in, my body goes, hang on, there's physicality here with thought, with no body present.
Yeah.
So I'm going to react. So how is it when people walk around like that, they wonder why people are taking offense to them all the same. Hey, pull your head in, mate, I'll punch your lights out.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
Because their light, they're bringing into their light into your invading your territory. Just by their mere presence. They do that, and if they've got a big strong jaw, what will they do? They'll tend to stick it out. Why? Because it's their strongest point, and they'll feel protected by it. They pull their head in, come back to themselves, and just be yourself. So coming home to ourself, going back, then the challenge that is, you're going to have all your feelings rise up because you're going to open the throat chakra, and I say, tell me what you feel. Don't tell me what you think.
Yeah.
Or when you're telling me whatever, have feeling. But I can't, I've never done that. You just tell everyone what you think, but you don't tell everyone how you feel. Because it'll upset them. It's like, well, what's right action for you is right action for others.
Yeah.
That's my answer to that.
Yeah.
And if we don't give birth to what we feel, how can we feel?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
We can't be who we think we are. Because while we're being who we think we are being who we actually are. But we're not intermeshed with that. We're not one with it. And don't have a sense of ourself.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's coming home to ourself. So this work, just by that little amount, when if anybody's having an interaction with someone, it pays to know who you're communicating with.
Yeah.
And you'll already know this. Like this feeling already exists, but to be able to, I say give head office. For me, it was like I was very intuitive and very empathetic, empathic. But I was having all this feeling about someone, but it's like, but I'm still dealing with this thing, and my mind's going, but there, but they're like this. Now I can say my head office can go, oh yeah, but they're like, oh no, it's just because they're doing that and because they're like that. Oh, that's right. So I can relax and go, it's okay. I can say to my feelings, it's okay, they're like this and they're being like that, and then I can
respond.
Get a better understanding and respond to them. And while I'm doing this, people have a sense that there's no judgment at all.
Yeah. Okay.
Because we're all learning something.
Yes. Yeah.
Everybody, it's a beautiful science. So be gentle with people, you have no idea what they're going through. No idea what they're going through. If you want to people to heal, then listen to them.
Yeah.
Listen to what they have to say and be interested. But if you haven't done this for yourself, Chris, can't do it for someone else.
Right. Yep. That's what we often
say. You ask me for blueberries and I haven't got any, what am I going to do? Can't give them to you, can I?
That's right.
Yeah?
Yeah.
But if you're looking for something and I like love for self, I have found this. So I have this, and inevitably what I have and given to myself, I will inevitably, every human will want to give it to another. People wish to, always wish got something good, they want to share it with others.
Yeah.
Look what I found.
Yeah.
Only hurt people hurt people. Because they're wishing to assimilate and relate and connect. I was saying it's everything is either an expression of love or it's a plea for it. So if you're able to sit with yourself, then you can sit with anybody. And it's a beautiful thing to allow people to actually get to know themselves and to be okay with themselves.
Yeah.
It's like people, I have people now look at me sometimes, I meet them, and what the really confident, strong ones who are really checking people all the time.
Yeah.
You have another thing where they said your eyes are deep set under your brow, So you're very watchful as well.
Okay.
You're able to, it's like you're back in your cave and you're sitting back in there and you have a sense of protection because it can't actually get your heart because you have this protection.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
And they're deep in there, so it allows you to actually look out with this division to be able to observe and see really where people are and what's happening. Whereas people with eyes are really prominent, you'll know some really eyebrows and their eyes are really out there, everything's running through their heart all the time.
Yeah,
they're
okay.
Kind of like, okay. It's like, but they're not actually feeling safe.
Yeah.
So it's the other thing that I felt, the discernment that you have and the watchfulness are the two things that I felt about you straight away, and I thought, that's perfect, look what you're doing. You're discerning and you're watchful, you're able to sit back in there and watch and not feel the need to come forward straight away. You hold your heart back.
So much of what you've said has resonated with a lot of what I'm aware of in myself, and as well as that, it is such a rare thing, Ken, to have someone sit with you and pay such close attention to who you are and to how your physiology has grown and formed around who you are as a person and your experiences as a child and as a just as a
yours
person.
Has,
exactly.
Yeah,
when I say you, I mean the sort of royal you, you know. All this. But for me, you know,
around one,
and you know, I feel like you've been listening to me very, very attentively, and that's a rare gift. And so, thank you. Simone Weil, I don't know if you know Simone Weil, but she said, she was a French philosopher, she said, attention is the rarest and purest form of generosity.
Uh-huh.
It's beautiful, isn't it?
Yes.
And I feel like you, in what you do, in what you've done for me now, is you've sat here and you've paid deep and close and compassionate attention to who I am. And you've been honest with me. There's no sense in which you're just trying to say, hey, you're great at this and you're lovely at this and you're a beautiful person. And you've been warm and discerning and honest with me about the way my face, the way my features tell the story of who I am and the way I respond to the world and to those around me. And so much of what you've said about me, I can recognize in myself. So thank you, Ken. I deeply appreciate what you've given me.
It's a joy and it's a real pleasure, and it's a wonderful thing to for anybody to learn as we teach this. And once you learn this and see this, and it's very easy because we already know these things. I mean, when people watch other people getting read, they're fascinated.
Yeah.
I knew that about them.
Yes.
Oh, that's so true.
Yeah.
And then the wheels start.
Yeah.
And you start looking at people and it's like, God, you sit on the train and it's like, oh God, look at that person. They think this and think that, and that's not true.
Yeah.
You actually like this and that.
Yeah.
So yeah, it's a beautiful thing to be able to give someone a sense of who they are again. And give them feedback.
Yeah. Yeah.
The world's hungry for it.
Absolutely. Yeah, the whole world is crying out for someone to listen.
Yes.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, thank you, brother.
Yeah.
I really do.
Beautiful.
I do thank you. Yeah.
Yeah.
Let's leave it there, hey?